I welcome you all on behalf of the NIAS Literary Arts and Heritage Forum, which is an initiative of the School of Humanities at NIAS. I'm now Professor Sharada. She's had to travel unexpectedly, so I'm just taking her place in introducing Mother, who is a speaker for this afternoon. The forum is currently coordinated by Professor Sharada, so which is why it was planned that she would chair it, but anyway. We carry on because it looks like there's a really diverse audience waiting to hear what Madhav has to say. So Madhav is a writer and a poet, and I understand that before this he used to work in mathematics. Yeah, so I was actually interested in that shift from mathematics to literature, but he's going to today focus on talking about Dattatreya Ramachandra Bendre's works. He's been translating his works for about 4 years now. And the idea behind today's talk is to just introduce the diverse range of the poet's works to a broader audience. So I'll hand over to Madhav now. Thank you.
Thank you, Rupa, for the introduction. Thank you to NIAS and Literary Arts and Heritage Forum. I don't know that Professor Sharada couldn't make it, and that's too bad, but it's being recorded, so hopefully she can do the recording. And it's nice to see all of you here too. I was hoping a lot of, there are a lot of unfamiliar faces, which is nice and glad, but I'm hoping for a number of familiar faces too, and that seemed like they're going to show up on time, which is typical, I suppose. And so I'll just begin. Thank you all for coming. So, how many of you are familiar with Bendre? And so the others aren't, I imagine. And those of you who are familiar with Bendre, how many of you are familiar with Ambika Tanayadatta? Okay, so, there's a distinction that I might make if I have the time to, but there's a lot of poetry ahead, and so I'm just going to make a few points, take about 5 minutes to introduce what's going to come and offer some context to it, and then maybe a few tidbits too is what I intend to mention. So what I'm going to present today are can accurately be called transcreations, rather than translations. The Kannada word for it is bhavanuvada. I think it's also used in Hindi, bhavanuvada. And essentially you're translating the bhava, the rasa, the emotion, the feeling that the poetry evokes in you. And I think translating Bendre is the best way to go about it, simply because he would have approved. When he translated Kalidasa's Meghaduta and invented a new meter to do so, he called it a bhava grahana, a sort of a capturing of the bhava, the spirit. The spirit is really the right word, I think. The spirit of the work, and so that's what I've done with these transcreations, and I'll be using transcreations and translations interchangeably. Bendre is known as Kannada's varakavi, and there's a reason for it. Very soon after he became known, it took him a while to become known, because only in his 30s that he became known. Also, I have a tendency to speak rather quickly, so if I'm doing so, let me know and I'll slow down, especially when I'm reciting these poems and all that. So, yeah. Once he became known, it became apparent to everybody that this was not some ordinary man, he was writing as though inspired, and he really was inspired, which is where this distinction between Dattatreya Ramachandra Bendre, Dara Bendre, and Ambika Tanayadatta comes. He believed that Ambika Tanayadatta was the Daivi Shakti, the divine spirit. There's a word in English that comes from the Greek called daemon, D-A-E-M-E-N or D-A-I-M-O-N, that is essentially something that inspires you. The word inspiration itself means inspire, so the gods are sort of breathing words into you and you're the medium. So, as a consequence of him being the varakavi, his poetry abounds in three qualities that lyric poetry is best known for. the nada, laya and prasa. Bhava of course feeling, but nada meaning euphony. Euphony is just something like pleasant sound, musical sound, you know, something that's pleasant to the ear. Prasa is rhyme, again part of Sanskrit poetics, and laya is rhythm, you know. And so these three just form the backbone of his poetry, and no matter how complex his poems were, they never failed to have at least one of these three qualities, and usually all three qualities in abundant measure, you know. And so that's one of the reasons he hasn't really been translated and become as well known as he should have been, which is one of the reasons I'm giving this talk and I've been trying to popularize his poetry. A lot of his poems, because they're so full of nada, are very singable, you know. And so most people are introduced to his poems as songs, and I too was one of them. And what that helped me do is create make transcreations that in English, which is a non-phonetic language, that somehow mirrored the phonetic patterns of a language like Kannada, and perhaps was also singable in a few cases. For instance, I'll just quote a couple of lines. A well-known song, and this tune is well-known too. Maru sadhan kerige marali ninni urige kamtu sadhan keri back to your town where you were married. So this is what I mean by saying that I've used his songs to inform the rhythms and rhymes of my own poem, transcreations.